Within the last few decades, scientists have discovered that the human proteome is vastly more complex than the human genome. While it is estimated that the human genome comprises between 20,000 and 25,000 genes, the total number of proteins in the human proteome is estimated at over 1 million. These estimations demonstrate that single genes encode multiple proteins. Genomic recombination, transcription initiation at alternative promoters, differential transcription termination, and alternative splicing of the transcript are mechanisms that generate different mRNA transcripts from a single gene. The increase in complexity from the level of the genome to the proteome is further facilitated by protein post-translational modifications. Post-translational modifications are chemical modifications that play a key role in functional proteomic because they regulate activity, localization, and interaction with other cellular molecules such as proteins, nucleic acids, lipids, and cofactors. In general, protein modifications can be of two different types. One is called as co-translational modification and another is called as post-translation modification. The difference between the two is that, if the process of modification or changing of one or more amino acid in a protein starts while they are still attached to the ribosome, that is called as co-translation modification. As you can see in this picture that this protein is still attached to the ribosome, and the ribosome is still moving along the mRNA, but these chaperones start attaching themselves with this protein and start folding it into the tertiary and quaternary state. Folding is considered a category of modification. So this type of protein modification is called co-translational modification. On the other hand, post-translation modification means that once the process of translation is ended and the protein is no longer attached itself to the ribosome, and now the process of changing of one or more amino acid or attachment of a non-protein part occurs to this protein, this type of modification is called post-translation modification. As we know that when the process of translation starts, the first start codon, AUGUST, codes for methionine in a eukaryotic organism or N-formyl methionine in a prokaryotic organism. In both situations, methionine is the first amino acid that is generated in a protein. However, a protein like collagen, there is no methionine. In collagen protein, there are only three amino acids, that is glycine, proline, and lysine. It means that the terminal amino acid, methionine, is cut off from that protein by the enzymes called proteases. The proteases will cut out the methionine from procollagen and undergo further process to form tertiary and quaternary protein in order to make be active. The second type of modification is called the trimming of signal sequence. When the newly synthesized protein is fully translated, it can be inactive. The first 15 to 30 amino acid that is present at the N-terminal of the protein is called a signal sequence. This signal sequence dictates where the protein goes, whether it is going to the nucleus, remained in the cytosol, going into the mitochondria, or being secreted to extracellularly. Once the protein is localized at its destination, the signal sequence needs to be removed to make the protein active and perform its function. One good example is the hormone insulin. At first, preproinsulin is translated as a 110 amino acid chain. Removal of the signal peptide produces proinsulin. Formation of disulfide bonds between the A and B chain components, and removal of the intervening C chain, produces a biologically active insulin molecule comprising 51 amino acids, less than half of the original translation product. Proteins can also undergo the process of covalent modifications. These modifications include phosphorylation, acetylation, disulfide cross-linking, carboxylation, methylation, and hydroxylation. Let's take a look at this polypeptide and see how some of the major covalent modifications are occurring on it. Starting from the N-terminal chain of this polypeptide, we can see that the phosphorylation is occurring on serine amino acid, followed by the acetylation at the lysine residue with the addition of the acetyl group. Next, we will find cysteine is making disulfide cross-linking with another cysteine molecule in this polypeptide chain. Further on, we can see a proline that is attached with hydroxy group, and this process is called hydroxylation. When we move forward, we can see arginine is attached with methyl groups that is called methylation. Note that methylation can be di- or trimethylation depending on 2 or 3 methyl group are attached to that amino acid. At the last amino acid, glutamine is attached with the carboxyl group, and the process of modification is called carboxylation. The function of each covalent modification is different depending on the type of protein it has. Let's take the real-life example of all these type of modifications, and see how this modification is affecting their function. For example, casein is a protein that is present in the milk, and it usually helps the attachment of calcium ions within our bone. If we look closely at this protein, we can see that it has a lot of serine amino acid. The serine amino acid is usually phosphorylated. Serine phosphorylation of casein help the protein to bind calcium ions and deliver it to the bones and make us stronger. Another example is the acetylation of microtubules. Microtubule is present in every cell. They have numerous functions. The main function is present during mitosis and meiosis, where the chromosome attached themselves with the spindle fiber. If a crack or damage occur at one part of the microtubule, acetylation will occur on the lysine residue at the position 40. The lysine 40 acetylation prevent the microtubule to bend and allow the repair process to take place. On the other hand, if there is no acetylation occur, the crack will go bigger and results in the breakage of the microtubule. Histone proteins are present inside the chromosome in the form of a nucleosome, in which 8 histone proteins are surrounded by DNA molecule. Histone proteins play a major role in the process of transcription regulation. The histone proteins' tails can be modified with methyl group. In this picture, the green modifications shown here are methylations that activate gene transcription. If the methylation is occurring on the red areas or the red positions of lysine residue, it will halt the process of transcription. So, the major function of histone protein methylation is to act as a regulator for the process of transcription. As we mentioned earlier, collagen is the main protein in our body. It is present in our nails, cartilage, bone and connective tissue such as skin. Collagen have 3 different type of amino acid that is highly modified with the hydroxyl group. When hydroxy group is attached to each polypeptide chain, collagen can convert itself into the cross-linked tropocollagen in order to perform its function. In the absence of hydroxylation, they will not form the tropocollagen. They will get degraded. If it gets degraded, it will affect our skin, nails, hair, or any part of the body where collagen plays its function. Immunoglobulin G or IgG is a type antibody that is present in our immune system to protect us against bacteria or viral infection. If we look closely at the structure of this antibody, we will find a lot of intercross-linked disulfide bonds. These interconnected disulfide bond held IgG to be in its shape and perform its function. Prothrombin is a protein in our blood vessel that helps in blood clotting. The glutamate residue at the end terminal of the prothrombin is usually carboxylate to allow binding of calcium ion that is necessary to initiate blood clotting. Glycoproteins are proteins that has a carbohydrate attached to it. There are 2 different type of linkages. One is called the O linkage that usually observed on the serine and threonine residue, and N linkage that usually occur on asparagine residue. Carbohydrate is a very big family of molecules. This include mannose, galactose and glucose, and many more. Another type of post-translational modified protein is lipoprotein. Lipoprotein consists of a lipid group that allow the protein to attach themselves onto the cell membrane. Because lipids are hydrophobic in nature, the attachment of protein to cell membrane is not possible without the attachment to the lipid family. There are 3 different types of protein-lipid linkages. First, there is the linkage of palmitoyl group on the internal cysteine or serine residue. Second, the myristoyl group can also attach to the glycine residue. And third, the binding of the farnesyl group on the carboxy terminal of cysteine. With these 3 different types of attachments with the lipid, the protein can anchor itself with the cell membrane and plays its functions. Metalloproteins are proteins that have a metal ion attached to it as a cofactor. An example of metalloprotein is hemoglobin. As we know, the hemoglobin has iron attached to it in the form of a heme group to carry oxygen. Because the binding of the iron to the protein changes the color of the protein, hemoglobin is also referred as chromoproteins. Protein folding is another type of protein modifications. After the protein is translated, there are two different types of protein folding. One is done by itself and another one needs a helper protein called chaperone. Chaperone attach themselves with the newly translated protein and help it to fold in a correct form. Finally, protein degradation. Protein degradation is also happening when the protein is translated. Sometimes, the protein translation is not done properly, and sometimes the external factors are damaging that protein. In such cases, the protein will undergo the process of degradation. Most protein degradation will be carried out when a ubiquitin chain attached to the protein, giving signals to the proteasome to recognize the protein that needs to be degraded. Once the attachment of ubiquitin chain happened, the proteasome will come and degrade the ubiquitinated protein into the amino acid, and that protein will lose its function. In summary, the human proteome is dynamic and changes in response to a legion of stimuli, and post-translational modifications are commonly employed to regulate cellular activity. Post-translational modification occur at distinct amino acid side chains or peptide linkages, and they are most often mediated by enzymatic activity. Post-translational modifications can occur at any step in the life cycle of a protein. Of note, protein post-translational modification can also be reversible depending on the nature of the modification. For example, kinases phosphorylate proteins at specific amino acid side chains, which is a common method of catalytic activation or inactivation. Conversely, phosphatases hydrolyze the phosphate group to remove it from the protein and reverse the biological activity. Consequently, the analysis of proteins and their post-translational modifications is particularly important for the study of human diseases.